are the Burks, and this is our story.
I absolutely grew up in church. My grandma took me. I remember going from, I don't know, probably the time I was 2 or 3 years old. Spent most of my childhood, teenage years for the Lord. And I grew up in a house that wasn't necessarily churchy. You know, my mom went to church when she was younger and she believed in God, but she never took me to church. That was all my grandma. I got pregnant when I was 18, so got married when I was 19, and stayed in church for a while. Ended up getting a divorce, and through that divorce, I was really angry and upset, and I didn't go to church for a long time. Going through divorce was horrible. I had 2 kids at the time. They were 9 and 12, and it was very hard for them, and I just questioned God a lot about why I was going through things. I grew up in a broken home. I didn't want to do that to my kids. I swore I never would do that to my kids. But it just came to the point where it was better for my kids to live in a healthy environment than to live through what we were living at that time. So it was pretty rough, and I let the devil get to me. When we separated, my ex asked me 3 things, and he said, "I don't want you to have my last name anymore. I don't want you to go to the same church as me, and I don't want you to sing anymore." And I went 12 years without singing because I was mad at the world.
Didn't really grow up in church. Didn't have that influence in my life as a kid. Didn't have it in my house. Not saying it was that grew up rough, but I mean, just they didn't push for it to go to church. They didn't influence in any other way. Honestly, had quite a few conversations with Pastor Berger a lot, just about, you know, the fact of getting to know him. And I went every now and then to another church. Never really felt like I belonged. Was just kind of felt like an outcast. Didn't really feel like I belonged in church until I started coming here around Annie's dedication.
We weren't faithfully going to church. We had been to a couple churches, you know, kind of like tried them out, and it just didn't feel like we fit anywhere. And, you know, Chad and Nana sucked us in with Annie's going to be dedicated and we need you to be there. I mean, it was shortly after her dedication that we both went to the altar, rededicated our lives, and basically just knew that somewhere, some way, there was going to be some type of ministry for us.
She was with her mom. I don't know all the details. All I know is that she ended up in the kiddie pool and ended up drowning. It was very hard because I felt like I didn't really have a relationship with my daughter because I didn't get her a lot. I really turned to Jen and Gabe and Morgan. They were kind of my rock.
He ended up having to have all of his teeth pulled because he had bad teeth. And when you have bad teeth, that can lead to infections. Because he was getting radiation basically from cheekbone to collarbone, all of this area was going to be basically very infection prone. So he had to get all of his teeth pulled, and then he ended up getting a feeding tube. And then he started treatments, 35 radiations, 8 weeks of chemo, hydration daily at the hospital for months, speech therapy. We did that for months to learn how to swallow and how to talk. He did not talk for 3 months. He did not say one word out loud. He slowly started to come back to life probably April-ish of that year, so it would have been April of 14. By June of 14, he was on the softball field. By August of 14, he was accidentally sliding with a feeding tube. He says he fell down.
When he was diagnosed the first time, we were going to church, not faithfully, but we were definitely going to another church. And, you know, when we were there, you know, we're praying for you, they would pray, they would hug him, they would love him. But outside of church, nothing ever happened. We were kind of just lost.
Because of the radiation, he ended up having a lot of complications to his vertebrae and his neck. They're very, basically, they're soft, and they don't hold up very well. So he's had some hardware put in.
I mean, it was tough to get. So I felt like I was so close to, like, getting over the hump. And I just felt like I got kicked right back down to the bottom again.
We went for follow-up in October, and the x-rays came back, and they pop up on the screen, and I had worked in orthopedics, and I have seen lots of x-rays, and I've seen lots of hardware. It was very obvious that the hardware had come out in his neck. So then we have to go see the ENT again. This time they decide to do a surgery together. We scheduled that for January of 2022. ENT came in, told me everything was great. It took about 3 hours for him to release all the scar tissue. He removed a lipoma. He did some other things. Released some very thick bands that he had in his neck, just to kind of give him a little bit more range of motion. And he basically said, I tagged out. The other surgeon tagged in. Everything should be smooth sailing from here. And the surgeon called me about 2 hours later and basically said, and I honestly will never forget it. He said, the first part of the surgery is complete, but I'm going to schedule the second half for Tuesday. I just tested positive for COVID. That Saturday, he aspirated, and they called a code on him because he was trying to die. He was basically suffocating on his own saliva, which led to a million more things happening. He ended up having the second surgery that Tuesday, but they put him on a vent. Even when I can't see it, even when I can't feel it, we knew that God was there and that God was playing a part. And honestly, Pastor Steve played a huge part in his faith growing. And I think that's because he made intentional attempts to connect with him outside of church, to pray with him. Pastor Steve prayed with us in the parking lot at St. Rita's at 5 a.m. the morning of surgery. We had no clue he was there. I'm like, you could have met us at our house. We live in Salina. You know, he drove to the hospital just to pray with him in the parking lot. And I told him later, I said, that's the first time that someone from church has prayed with him out loud. It wasn't like a group prayer. It was really, you know, showing him what God loved me.
Pastor Steve, just being up there at the hospital almost every day to visit, you know, saying a prayer. And I think even one time, Paige sat in the room with
me.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, yeah. Officer Paige. We had a church family that cared and reached out to us in ways we could not imagine. Driving back and forth to St. Rita's, sometimes twice a day, three times a day. It was hard. And we had people here help us financially. We had people help us with meals. We definitely had prayers, and we knew when we felt the love. And I told Pastor Steve, that's the first time he's really felt love, God love, outside of a church. You know, that people really care.
and that God put certain people in our paths for a reason.
This time around, I do know that I really do have God behind me to help. So every day I just gotta take it one step at a time and just gotta be patient. It'll happen on His time, not my time. I always tell like a bunch of the softball guys I play ball with over the years. Well, if they want to reply, let me know. If they don't, that's fine too. But I always tell them, if you just need somebody that you need want to vent to, just send me a message. You know what I mean? Because sometimes that's all people need too, is just to be able to send a message to somebody about how they're feeling during a certain situation or whatever that's going on in their life,
and not be judged.
And not be judged for it.
And reaching out, like I said, it doesn't have to be, you have to go to their house and you have to sit with them and pray with them for an hour. And no, I think sometimes the biggest ministries are the little things.